2017 was a year when Canada was truly back on the world stage in ways we have not seen before. Marijuana, NAFTA negotiations, influx, climate control, or climate change.
A lot. And efforts to improve ties with China, even the death of a Canadian music icon.
And for the front row seat to that change, our Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau. Welcome and good morning.
It's great to be back.
How was traffic?
Not too bad, actually.
Okay, I'm just wondering, because I'm putting that in for John Tory just to see if we can get some money for the subway relief.
Well, actually, in about an hour and a half, I'm going to be announcing the York subway extension, which is a big, big piece of news.
And
a reminder that what we're doing on investing long-term in big infrastructure matters. This has been years. It goes back to before us, obviously. But getting to that end line means consistent investments in people, and that's what we're doing.
Let's talk about investments in people globally. A lot of eyes right now on NAFTA. We want to talk trade. So it's kind of hanging by a thread right now. A lot of conversations, but nothing solidified just yet. Where do things stand? And help us understand the importance of getting something done.
Well, I mean, the fact is that we are so interlinked with the United States in terms of trade. NAFTA's been great for us, for the U.S., even for Mexico, for the past 25 years. Of course, we need to update it, modernize it. There's all sorts of digital economy things to put into it. We want to put a little more around gender and environment because we know that's good for the economy and good for jobs. The American president has a bit of a different perspective on it. He's negotiating hard, but fundamentally, there are so many good jobs created on both sides of the border through NAFTA that we have to believe that we're going to end up in a good place.
Well, just last week, he said, you know what, I'm thinking I might walk away, but I like that Justin Trudeau fella up north. Would we then negotiate a deal? If NAFTA does fall through, would we go ahead and negotiate something separately with the states, and what would that do with our relationship with Mexico?
Well, I think, first of all, what we've learned is the president likes to be unpredictable, and therefore we have to brace ourselves and be ready for anything. So we are ready for the unexpected. We've got plans A through Z to kick in if things need to be. But we're just going to stay serious, focused, and working on not just trying to get a great deal for Canada, get a great deal for Canada, for the U.S. and for Mexico, because a win-win-win is what NAFTA has been all about, and it's what our relationship should be.
You just returned from China, obviously, and there's the criticism the Prime Minister didn't return with a trade deal. And how do you respond to that? And how do you respond to that criticism?
Oh, I think Canadians expect us not to get just any old deal, but to get a good deal and to get on the right track. One of the challenges we're seeing around the world is people turn inwards, people want to throw up walls, literal or metaphorical, and get more protectionistic, is that we have to make an argument that trade is good, not just for big businesses and a country's bottom line, but for individuals, for workers, for small businesses. And doing that means making the right deal. So it's not just like my predecessor likes to say, just no deal is worse than a bad deal. No, I think no deal is better than a bad deal. We need the right deal, and that's why we're putting forward high standards and expectations that we're going to be good for Canadians.
Speaking of small business, actually, Winston, we've solicited some questions from our viewers, and Winston, we have a comment here from someone about small business.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Thank you so much. One is, this is the first concern from a viewer, Ron Smith, about the impact of minimum wage and the hike on small businesses. Even though that is a provincial issue, Ron says that he's going to be impacted by the small business tax changes announced this week.
We're as a small business owner, I think we could have handled 25 to 50 cents an hour, but this big hike is going to be a killer. We're going to have to lay off, and it's only going to snowball because my people that are making $13 or $14 an hour, they also want an increase. So it's going to just keep continuing. The cost of living is going to be ridiculous, right? Nobody's going to win here except one person, and that's the government. And that's the increase in taxes that everybody's going to be paying.
Well, I mean, that's the minimum wage hike is a small, is a provincial issue, as was said. What we've done on the federal side is actually we're lowering small business taxes as of January 1st. That's a longstanding commitment, but we got to step back. I mean, as he was talking about, you know, the economy is always challenging. What we did 2 years ago is we said we're going to create growth that works for everyone by putting more money in people's pockets. First thing we did, we lowered taxes for the middle class, raised them on the wealthiest 1%, and we're delivering a Canada Child Benefit that puts more money in people's pockets. And the reason we did that wasn't just, you know, to make people feel good. It's because we know that economic growth happens from Canadians. Canadians being confident, Canadians investing, spending, growing their businesses. And what we believed in has actually happened over the past 2 years. We've created record number of new jobs, the best job growth numbers in 18 years. We're the fastest growing economy in the G7. That helps small businesses, that helps everyone. And this focus we have on growing the economy by concentrating on the people who need help is something that, quite frankly, the world's looking at.
I could hear small business owners yelling at their TVs right now. A lot of them are still, and they're letting me know, saying that when, in the end, January 1st, the changes to the small business tax is going to hurt a lot of them. Okay. And they're already facing, like we saw, provincial problems with the minimum wage, and they're facing rent hikes. Some of them are closing. Yonge Street is rife with the shops that have closed down.
Well, let's make it perfectly clear. 100% of all small businesses in this country are going to see their tax rates go down on January 1st, because we're keeping a commitment we made to lower small business taxes. Next year, we'll be lowering them all the way to 9%. So that's a very good thing. On the changes we made, we needed to make sure that that wealthy individuals who are using private corporations as a way of paying lower tax rates than middle class Canadians didn't have that advantage in the system. And that's a change. The income sprinkling change we're making, for example, only touches 3% of small businesses, and even then, a lot of them are going to be able to continue to ensure that their kids who work in the business, their wives or their husbands get to continue to benefit. So we're clarifying, we're making the system fair, and overall, we're helping small businesses by lowering taxes.
Well, a lot of the question, too, was the timeline on it. And some saying, why is it being introduced January 1st, 2018? Why not wait the year until there was more spread out and we could figure out exactly how this is going to roll out? Why the rush on it? Because, you know, there's been some criticism in the Senate with a report. Why now?
Well, when we move forward to lower taxes on the middle class and raise them on the wealthiest 1%, we announced that in December of 2015, and it kicked in right away on January 1st, 2016. This is a completely normal process, and if you think about it, we're making this change as of January 1st. People will have the entire year of 2018 to choose how to do their dividends to family members, and then they'll have another few months to prepare their taxes for that. So this is something that they're going to have, you know, 14, 15 months to implement, but right away, as of January 1st, they're going to pay smaller small business taxes.
Well, we were preparing, you know, we had such a short time with you, we were preparing some of our questions, and we brought up one particular topic, and I said, I don't think he's going to want to talk about that. I don't want to talk about it. It's all done. We know it's going to happen in April, so we're fine with all of this. What do you think the topic was that everybody wanted to talk about? And that is marijuana.
Okay.
And so let's get to one of the comments right now.
Sure.
Definitely one of the common themes. From the questions we've been getting, it's one of the common themes, and it's medical marijuana for pain control, for mental illness. We got this question from Diana Donnelly in Kingston. Take a look.
I represent a lot of people in Kingston who have PTSD, mental health issues. We use cannabis because it's safer. We use less of other medications when we're using cannabis. Why are you taxing our medicine? I've been using it for 18 months. I didn't pay that dollar tax. And for me, because I make my cannabis into edibles and oils, it's going to cost me $150 more a month for my medicine. I'm not sure that I can afford that, which means that the whole purpose of you legalizing is kind of going up in smoke.
Okay. Yeah.
It's almost impossible to talk about marijuana without making puns somewhere in there. We are moving forward on legalizing and regulating marijuana because right now our kids have easy access to marijuana. We have the highest rate of underage marijuana use of any developed country in the world. And criminal organizations, street gangs, and gun runners are making billions of dollars a year off of the sale of illegal drugs, and specifically off of marijuana. The medical marijuana industry is a side of things that we're actually not touching, but the fact is there are a lot of people who use the medical marijuana industry as a way of getting recreational marijuana. We are making that change so we can establish a legal way for adult users to buy marijuana. The medical system, we're going to look at once we've changed the system, but we're concentrating on keeping the system as much the same as we possibly can.
A lot of questions that we had from viewers surrounding policing agencies, because once it becomes legal, it's a gray area, being able to determine if someone is impaired in some way. So how is the federal government going to tackle this one? Because it is very gray.
Well, let's first of all be very, very clear. Right now, outside of a legalized regime, there are people consuming and driving. There are people who are misusing marijuana right now in ways that are dangerous for the general public. So one of the things we're actually able to do with this controlled and legalized regime is put in place better controls, better advertising, a better framework to handle what's already a behavior and prevent it from getting worse. So this is something that actually many police organizations are welcoming, the extra effort we're putting into intoxicated driving and drug-impaired driving.
All right, let's go back to Winston for one more.
One more question here from Michelle Newton. She's a teacher in Thunder Bay. She wants you to grade yourself.
In the new year, I'll be busy preparing report cards for my students, and my question to Prime Minister Trudeau is, if he could write his own report card on the last year, what would he say are his strengths and weaknesses, and what are the next steps moving forward?
Well, you know what? Every reporter seems to want to write a report card at the end of the year, so I'm not going to take away your work. You guys have a lot of work to do. I'm going to just stay focused on the things that we have to do for Canadians. You know, there's a lot of things that we got done over the past 2 years, but there's a lot more to do, and we're working really, really hard to listen to folks and their concerns.
Let's do that part of your report card then about what where we need improvement.
Where we need to continue focus is making sure we're listening to Canadians. And that's why this year, I mean, the challenge of being Prime Minister and the challenge of being in Parliament in Ottawa is often you have to really make deliberate efforts to get out and connect with people. And that's what our MPs are doing. And certainly in the new year, like I did last year, I'm going to be kicking off with a series of town halls where I'm going to get out and actually take direct questions from Canadians on a broad range of topics.
And they're not always comfortable.
Oh, no. No, they're tough questions, but quite frank, and I hate saying this, often they're tougher and better questions than the media gives me as well. That's why you reach out to viewers as well.
But they are the real questions, and you said, you know what, you have a very thick skin.
I was raised with people who loved me because of my dad and people who disliked me because of my dad, and I had to know that either way didn't define who I was, and that allows me to have a strong sense of who I am and take even unconstructive citizen and try and look at criticism and try and make the constructive element out of it.
As a baby boomer, I have to say, Canada has not been on the world stage like this with this kind of an image since your dad. How much of Pierre Elliott Trudeau is in Justin Trudeau on foreign visits, etc.?
I think I'm always extremely proud to be my father's son, but as we were talking before we went on, I'm incredibly proud to be my mom's son as well.
She's a wonderful woman. She is incredible.
Shaped by my parents, but I am my own person, and if Canada's, you know, having a bigger impact on the world stage, it's not because of me, it's because of Canadians, because we are doing the right kinds of things. And you know, Canada didn't randomly change 2 years ago when the government's changed. Canadians remain and have always been hardworking, optimistic, globally engaged people. I think we just have had a government that aligns and augments that a little bit more on the world stage.
All right, well, Prime Minister, you are on Breakfast Television, so we've got to have a little bit of fun. And we want to talk a bit about the holidays specifically, right around the corner. So we've got some rapid-fire questions for you, okay?
Okay.
Rapid answers.
First thing that comes to mind, okay?
Sure.
Cider or eggnog?
Nog.
Mild temps or winter wonderland? You're from Ottawa.
Definitely winter. If I want my winters cold and snowy.
Big get-together or small family gathering?
It's Christmas. You have to do both.
Load up on the main course or save room for dessert?
Oh, no. Thirds of main course. I'll skip on dessert.
Best holiday movie?
I can't get the Star Wars that I saw two nights ago out of my head, so that's what it is.
I put this one in here. Is Die Hard a Christmas movie, yes?
Yes, Die Hard is absolutely a Christmas movie.
Thank you.
No question about
it. The Prime Minister of Canada has just confirmed that.
Okay. Best holiday song?
Now you got the Let It Snow, because that's the end of the Die Hard movie in my head.
No. Yeah.
Actually, I love the Sarah McLachlan version of a Gordon Lightfoot song called Song for a Winter's Night that's absolutely extraordinary.
Well, we want to, I know that you, have you recorded your Christmas message yet?
I have recorded a couple of them. I may have more to do.
But nobody ever gets a chance to record a message to the Prime Minister and to your lovely wife, Sophie. From Canadians, like you or not, a Merry Christmas to our Prime Minister and his family, and we look forward to the new year, bigger and better for Canada.
Thank you. Merry Christmas to you all, and let's make sure we think of people for whom Christmas is going to be tough, as it always is for some.
Thank you so much for coming in.
All right. Pleasure.
It is 8:31 right now on Breakfast Television.